تم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. فما بعد, that is a rabbit and we're still in Ashley Reservoir. We come to the second part of it's a, actually a little bunny, it's a baby one who is not particularly alarmed. I don't want to alarm him, but there he goes. This bird is called a king bird. Don't ask me why. But there's some of these here. These are bulrushes, which have bullfrogs in them. Make very sonorous, going trom, trom, trom. And we have there my favorite bird, which is a red-shouldered blackbird, or a red-winged blackbird, which is sitting on that post. So you can see him, that's a male, so we know it's a male. And the females are sort of drab gray. The only species in which females are prettier than the males are the human race. Wildflowers is another one of my favorite passions, because there is so much of beauty that is there in nature, which is just there, incidental beauty. Why is it there? Because Allah wants it to be there. No other reason, and we don't need any other reason. There's a bumblebee doing his work. These pollinators, incidentally, they are what keep us alive. There's a famous saying that I think Einstein or somebody said it, that if all the bees died, if the bees became extinct, in 5 years the human race would become extinct. May Allah have mercy, but we mercilessly kill every insect we can find. The most implacable enemy of insects is the human being. Anyway, so this is this part of Ashley Reservoir that I wanted to share with you. So we come to the second word that Allah, our second job, the second thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which where he said, wa yuzakkihim. So yatlu alayhim ayatihi, recite for them the recitation that has been sent to you, the revelation that has been sent to you, recite for them. Not recitation, revelation. And then yuzakkihim. Now this gives you and me the biggest, the most powerful piece of evidence that points to the purpose of the revelation of the Quran. Because the purpose of the revelation of the Quran was not to simply recite it in, no matter how beautiful the voice might be, it was not simply to have debates and to have discussions and to have glorious conversations about the miracles of grammar, all of which are of course very important. These are the grammar of the Quran is a miracle in itself, and it's very, when I say that it's not the purpose, I don't mean to discount the importance of the grammar, and that's the reason why anyone who wants to do tafsir of the Quran, who wants to explain the Quran, the fundamental bottom line condition that our scholars have put on that is a complete and total knowledge of the language of Arabic. The Quran is Arabic. The Quran is in Arabic. The Quran is Arabic. The Quran al-Kareem is a book of Arabic grammar. And therefore, if anyone who does not know the language, and if you want to interpret what it means, if you want to reading it and understanding it in the best way possible and all of that, alhamdulillah, very good, should be done. I'm talking about placing yourself in the position of a teacher, which is the most dangerous position to place yourself in. It's like putting a target on your head as far as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is concerned, because students are deen are not culpable. Students are not punishable. Students are students. They are treated as students. They are forgiven. It is understood that they will make mistakes because they are learning. They are not culpable. But the moment you place yourself up there as a teacher, then you are putting a target on your forehead. And believe me, illa mashallah, unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mercy on you, that target will be hit. So be very careful. I know this is a big bimari, a big disease, and a disease that comes out of good intentions, where people come to me and say, Sheikh, I want to teach Islam to people. I want to teach Islam to people. What should I do? And my answer to them is, if you say, I want to teach people how to fly a plane, what would you do? He said, well, I would learn how to fly a plane. And then I would qualify, which means I would work under an instructor pilot who is qualified to qualify me. I would qualify as a trainer pilot, as somebody who has been given the ijaza, given the permission to train others. And only then will I be capable of training people. I said, fantastic. So you have the answer. You want to teach Islam? Get into that position. Learn Islam, practice Islam, and then get into a position and then work under, learn under a sheikh, learn under somebody who is qualified. When I say sheikh, it just doesn't mean somebody like me. I am allergic to murids. I don't take any students. I do not qualify anybody. So if somebody comes to you and says, I studied under Sheikh Yawar and therefore I'm qualified to teach, tell them you are lying, because Sheikh Yawar said he never qualified anybody. And the only reason that I tell people, people call me Sheikh, and I stopped objecting. I used to object all the time. I still do, and I have some energy for that. I tell myself the only reason they call me Sheikh is means an old man, which I am, alhamdulillah. Find a teacher who is qualified to qualify you, and then you can by all means teach. There's no problem. Teaching is not haram, but if you want to teach, you must make yourself worthy of teaching. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Quran, and Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given this, and he was given this job. Siyatlu alayhim ayati, he recite for them what has been sent, meaning let them understand what it is. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, wa yuzakkihim. And this is, as I said, is the biggest evidence that the Quran came to be obeyed. It came to be practiced. It didn't come for us to have seminars and discussions and debates and then live our lives the way we want to live our lives. No. Yuzakkihim. Allah said, prepare them, purify them, make them capable of receiving this divine message that has been sent down to you. Now, what more evidence do we need? Allah is saying, prepare yourself. Allah is saying, I sent the Nabi and I gave him this job of preparing you to receive this divine message. And why should we receive? Why do we need preparation? Because without preparation, you cannot, the message will not sink in. It will not sprout. It will not germinate. Good morning. And you will find yourself in a mess, because you will not understand the message and you will not be able to practice the message. So Allah does not want that for us. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, use a key. Preparation. What does tazkiyah mean? Tazkiyah is not just making wudu and ghusl. That is part of tazkiyah, obviously, which is the preparation or the purification of the external self. Here's another little bunny. So that is tazkiyah, but tazkiyah is a lot more than that, because the place of the Quran, the place the Quran resides in the human being is in the heart and in the mind, and it must reside in every cell of the body. It must be something which is a constant guide. It must be the sun in the warmth of which, in the life-giving rays of which we lead our lives. It must be the shade which shades us and protects us from the evil of shaitan and the evil of our nafs, evil of our desires. This is what the Quran should be, and it is. But for us to enjoy that, we have to prepare ourselves. It won't happen automatically, because nothing happens automatically. Everything happens in a time and a place. There's a context, and therefore it needs preparation. So that is what the Quran al-Kareem is, and this is the preparation. Yuzakkihim. Prepare them to receive the Kalam. So as I said, external purification, which would be your, purification of the body, and then internal purification, which is the taskiyatun nafs, the purification of the soul, purification of the heart. To free the heart from, number one is shirk, from joining partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You might say, well, I don't worship idols. No, you don't worship idols, but you don't worship idols made of stone or any material, but you worship, may Allah protect us, worship idols of the power and authority of the modern world, of those people who run the modern world. We think they can harm, they can benefit. We think that we look to them for our, for the needs of our lives. If something goes wrong, we say, oh, you see, this is because we have a bad president, bad prime minister. If the leadership changed, everything would change, and so on and so forth. Now, this is where the big, big problem comes. And that is part of shirk. Part of shirk also is to obey our desires in opposition to obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called it shirk. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَاهَهُ هَوَى. Allah said in Surah Al-Furqan, Allah said, have you not seen, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, those who have taken their desires, their hawa, as their ilah. Allah used the word ilah. Allah said their deity, the thing they worship is not Allah. What they worship is not Allah. Who they worship is not Allah. What and who they worship is their own desires. Now, you might say, well, how do I worship my desire? You worship your desire by giving the desire precedence over what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you to cover your body and your head, to wear a hijab, to wear clothing which is not revealing. But your mental conditioning Western upbringing tells you that these are symbols of oppression, and these are symbols of slavery. And what you should ideally tell them is that yes, they are symbols of slavery to Allah, and that's the only slavery which is permissible. And that's a little chipmunk there. I am a slave of Allah. I am Amatullah. I am a slave of Allah. So I have no problem expressing that. But we don't, because we don't have confidence in our religions. So we take the hijab off and we take some of our clothes off, and we think we are very, liberated and modern and so on and so on. So this is slavery to the nafs, slavery to the self, slavery to desire, and this is shirk. So purification of the heart consists of removing this. Also removing all kinds of negative emotions and thoughts, removing hatred and removing greed and envy and jealousy, all the good stuff that is part of our social life, riba, backbiting, slander, all the spicy stuff in our conversations. May Allah have mercy on us. We have conversations which are a sign of the lowest form of thinking in life. People who talk about other people. There's nothing lower and more despicable than somebody who talks about others. Talk about ideas. Morning, how are you? Talk about ideas. Talk about the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, a majlis in which Allah is not mentioned is a majlis of dead people. The hearts are dead because nothing is there. So, tazkiyatun nafs. And then tarbiyatul akhlaq, which is how is this pure soul to be expressed in terms of my behavior? Because I can't say I have a soul that is pure from jealousy and envy, and then I'm clinging to things, I am uncharitable, I'm doing stuff which is not worthy of that. I can't do that. So tarbiyatul akhlaq. I won't go further in this because this is a further reminder, but I have, may Allah bless all my friends and students in Hyderabad. On the insistence, I did a series called Tazkiyatun Nafs wa Tarbiyatul Akhlaq. I will ask Umair to put the link to that in this. If I'm not mistaken, there are a total of 50 Fajr reminders. I did this as a series of Fajr reminders, and we did, I think, 50 or 52. So it was a whole year, not a year, mere meaning, I mean, 52 weeks, but so 50 to 52 of them. Take your time, listen to them, reflect on them, try and implement them in your life, and then go forward. So listen to the first one, and then work on it. And once you're satisfied with how that's going in your life, then go to the next one. This was the way in which the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in, may Allah be pleased with all of them. This is how they approached the deen. This is how they approached Islam. This is how they learned the Quran, by listening, by implementing, and then going forward. So we have covered two of the aspects. Yatlu alayhim ayatihi wa yuzakkihim. Recite for them the kalam and purify them, so that they can receive the kalam. Their hearts are now fit to receive the kalam. We ask Allah to bring us to this stage, and then we go to the next one. Inshallah, wa sallallahu ala nabiyyil kareem wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin.